morning. It's now Saturday and it's a lovely sunny day. Very breezy though. Last night was really mild. When it got darker, the breeze had actually kicked up during the afternoon, which I actually caught head on when I was actually paddling here, created quite a sort of a rift in the water to a point where it was even stronger than a wake of maybe a boat that's just sort of gone past you and you're paddling into the wake of that boat. But all last night the sky was clear, you could see all the stars, so it was a lovely evening. But so the chill factor sort of got down, so I put my thermal parka liner on and also my thermal trousers that actually go underneath my normal cargo trousers. So that kept me warm as well once I actually went to sleep in the old two-season sleeping bag. I haven't used this for a while, but if you follow my vids and my outdoor pursuits, you'll have seen this before, a little thin thermal heat reflector. It works really well actually. I was using this before I actually inflated the mat, which is a 3/4 length. So it was a really comfortable night's sleep, albeit it was a bit of a chill factor in the air. But then to say the breeze has actually really kicked up this morning. And it's blowing the tarp around a little bit, but you know, the wind is actually coming towards me this way, so it's sort of starting to bellows up a little bit. It's not too much of a wind trap. I mean, strategically, putting a configuration of a tarp, you'd want to position your tarp or whatever sort of pitch configuration that you're camping in, sort of where you're not going to be vulnerable to the breeze. But I mean, it's not that gusty wind, albeit this was the actual position, so I can actually see everything around me, access point. Also, I could have positioned the tarp in a place that maybe if, you know, it had been really gusty wind, it would have been vulnerable. But this, because of the uprights, and this is where I knew I wanted to actually pitch the tarp, and the actual configuration, the sort of three-section box, where obviously I've got the floor here, then the broadside, and then the roof, using the 8x12 lightweight plastic tarp. Problem being is that these lightweight, sort of cheaper ones, obviously you get what you pay for. It's practical, it's lightweight, it really rolls up into a really light package for when you're transiting your kit. And I've mentioned it before, the eyelets in these sort of plastic tarps are not as strong as a webbing loop that you might have on an army issue or a type of tarp which is much more strong, which is more strongly structured. But of course, having the bungee cords has got that flexibility, as you can see on that corner there as the wind blows. So if it does bellows up, as it has done a few times, there we go, there you can see it on the broad open edge. The flexibility of the bungee cord allows the movement whereby it doesn't actually damage the eyelet in the corner where it's actually hooked. Of course, if the weather had really turned bad, you know, if it was a different time of year, then obviously I would have adjusted the configuration of the tarp so it's relevant to be safe and practical for those particular weather conditions, like with the rain and with the wind kicking in. But I mean, it did the job last night, so, and it enabled me to actually stay in the position that I wanted to sleep in. And also, if I did have to get up during the night or there was any disturbance, I can actually see everything around me from a vantage point of where I'm sleeping. I've mentioned it before as well, I like to keep a sort of an open space to actually get out, obviously, from where I was sleeping, and then just amalgamated all my kit, cooking kit and everything, at this particular spot here. So if there was any rain, it wasn't forecast, but at least it was underneath the tarp and all in one space. But anyway, I'm going to redistribute some of this. Unfold my seat that's just behind that paddle blade, and just set everything up here and make myself some breakfast. But before I actually make up my breakfast, the relevance of what I'm just going to show you here, obviously you can see the fixings, the back two corners, and then obviously the front two corners. But then that gives me a bit of a surface here. It was clean, there was no rain, there's no sort of residue off the trees or anything. So what I've done, I've shaken any sort of dust and bits of dry grass, obviously, because that's what I'm surrounded by, off of the inside of the sleeping bag, and then zipped it up, and I'm just about to shake off whatever's on the outer surface. So without having to do it near to ground level, you're not sort of packing away bits of grass or bits of grit and what have you. once any bits of dust and what have you have been shaken off, then obviously I can then just put it on here, fold it up, as if this is really just sort of like a working surface really. Obviously you've got to be careful because obviously it's going to bow up and blow at the other side and defeats the object, and you get it covered in grit and grime. So I've just basically shaken it out and I'm going to pack it away, get it out of the way because I don't have to air it, because I'm not using it again. I'm just going to pack it away and take it home today. How I utilised my utility belt to carry a pouch for the camera, Mora 510 on a carabiner, so it's easily to take on and off if I'm not actually using it and I don't actually want to have it on my person. And then my EDC pouch I always carry with me, even sort of like domestic day wear, which has got a phone in it, wallet, keys, although my keys I've actually put securely somewhere else so I'm not actually carrying them around while I'm moving around at camp. Pen there, little notebook in there, and then where the sort of like webbing clip strap comes over the front of this pouch, I actually undid it here, you can see the clip, and then threaded it through the loop of this black pouch that the through night torch comes in. So although it was horizontal, it actually did the job where the main things I needed to have on my person around my waist were on my utility belt, and that's how I sort of improvised it and adapted it for the past 24 hours. So as mentioned last night, in my food bag, which I've started to use quite a bit, is another MRE, meatballs in pasta and tomato sauce, so that's if I want to heat that up, or I can even eat it cold, and there's a chocolate pudding there and chocolate sauce. But I always, always carry Pexamine stove, always as backup. So if anything that's a bit more technical fails, which I'm ready to do the toast with the Coleman stove, this fully loaded with blocks and a cigarette lighter in there as well. So I always keep this on me wherever I go, whenever I go out to do any outdoors activity. Instead of bringing a tin of milk or even fresh milk in a sealed plastic container, I brought these instead. I've got an all-in-one coffee there with a bit of added extra sugar, and if I do want to cool it down, I'll probably add one of those milks, but I used it in a cup of tea late last night before I settled for bed, so those little tubs of milk came in quite nice and handy. Tomato sauce, a little bit of oil next to it to do the scrambled egg and butter. The saucepan that I did the prawns in last night, what I did, I wiped out all the residue and then filled it about half with water, boiled it on the Coleman stove, and then used this scourer and just pushed my spoon on it and just wiped it round the inside and kept sort of agitating it while it was actually still on the simmer boil. So it sort of sanitised it, cleaned it, got rid of the flavour. I mean, it doesn't really matter if a bit of sort of prawny flavour goes into my scrambled egg and tinned spaghetti and sausages. So this nice and clean and sanitised, all ready to cook first thing in the morning. So that's the toast done, just resting on the lid of the box that the actual bread came in. So doing the things that take the longest, so that's the toast done. so that can cool down, and I'll butter that. So whether it's warm or cold doesn't really matter. And then put the kettle on for the brew. Then of course that will go in there, and then that drink will be ready for just the 2-3 minutes that that's going to take to cook. Then it will be ready within a good economy of time. Because I'd cut the slices of bread in half, it made it easier to put in the box, but each slice I've actually buttered on my leg on the lid, and then as I finish them I've actually put them in the box there, which is clean. So as each piece of toast that I want to dip and eat with my eggs breakfast, I can just serve out the box. So it's improvising with actually what I've got, without bringing loads of plates and dishes and bowls and all that sort of thing, because I'll be eating out the saucepan. I out of the bags of the MREs, and I'll be just serving the toast out of the box. So all practical stuff and least amount of kit. So it saves bringing a load of other cooking utensils or plates, when actually you can improvise with other bits of kit, like storage kit, that I've actually brought the food in. Rather than use the oil to knock up the scrambled egg, I had some butter left over from the toast. So I've just got it on a low heat on the burner. I'm just going to let that melt through, and then I'm going to scramble up the eggs with the butter and just move the eggs aside and then empty that with it. So I've now taken the saucepan off the heat so it doesn't sort of fry the eggs really, and then I can sort of mix them up so it gets an equal scrambled consistency. Put that back on the heat, cook them through. What I've decided to do is add one of these creamers. Well, it's actually condensed milk, which is sort of quite sweet. Plus as well, it's creamy, so without milk, adding one of these just to give it a little bit of a different taste and consistency. The standard recipe for scrambled egg is a bit of seasoning, maybe salt, pepper, butter, and some milk. So that will do nicely. I don't want any salt and pepper with it. So what I've done now is I've just taken it off the heat briefly so that my eggs don't sort of go dry. I like them a sort of a soft consistency when I do scrambled egg, sort of a moisture and creaminess to them. And then of course emptied the spaghetti, tin spaghetti and sausages, and then offer that part mainly to the heat, keeping the scrambled egg slightly to the edge of the burner. So the majority of the heat being underneath now, the spaghetti and the sausages, I've still got the scrambled egg keeping warm, but it's not going sort of more solid. So it's keeping the consistency, and that's virtually enough heated through. So I've spooned some of the scrambled egg and the spaghetti and the sausage onto the toast, and absolutely spot on. Bon appetit. What I've decided to do is actually show you what I did last night after cooking with the prawns. The residue that's been left over from the spaghetti, sausage and scrambled egg, obviously there wasn't really much left. And with a piece of kitchen paper towel, I just wiped off the majority of whatever residue was there, and then put a little bit of water, it's only about an inch of water, and then just sort of demonstrating what I did. Once it's come to the boil, one of these sort of stainless steel scourers, which I find tend to work pretty good, especially on stainless steel. You haven't got to worry about anything else being scratched if it was like plastic that you're cleaning or washing. But save getting the washing up bowl, just putting it now on a simmer, and it's just cleaning all the residue off. And also I'll bring this up around the top edge as well, so it's clean, so that if I did want to use it again for cooking, I could do, albeit if I do have another meal this afternoon, it'll be a boil in the bag. But just showing you, putting in perspective of just cleaning a single utensil without having to do a bowl of washing up. And then that will just be rinsed out and emptied on the fire pit. The coals have already actually gone down now, so there's nothing there that's ignitable or combustible. But say pour that on the coals, and that will add to LNT, leave no trace, once that fire pit's filled in. Then I'll just dry the saucepan with a piece of paper tissue kitchen roll.
And after using the scour, I've just shook it out and just put it on one of the rods that fastens the cooker wind guard into the ground, so that can just drain off there and also dry. What I tend to do when I know my fire pit has finished at the end of the night and I know I'm not going to use it again, I'll spread all the ashes so that they equally distribute, and then it's easier for them to actually go out and for the heat to reduce, and then there's nothing combustible. But say, just add in this water as well, and then I'll mix it all in before I actually leave no trace and fill the fire pit.
Okay, so I'm just starting to pack up now, and before I strike down my basher, the three section box sort of configuration, to show you the base where the two corners were pegged, just happened to marry up actually with the eyelets at the rear and then at the other end over there, and of course the two front ones. So of course that was my ground sheet space, then with a broadside, and then of course with the roof on top, all in one unit. If there was any adverse weather conditions, I could have always dropped this down a little bit, and also the other one, and then this edge I could have actually dropped, so where that fixing was would have come down further, so I'd have had a more enclosed low profile sort of A shape, like my finger and thumb. LNT, leave no trace, fire pit sorted, basher struck down, and before I load up the canoe and make my way back, I've got the kettle on the brew there, or should I say on the boil, to have a nice cup of tea while I just sit in the sunlight. And when I do paddle back, the sun's going to just start to lower to the west. Oh yeah, all ready to go in there. A little bar of chocolate, four of them will go in, so I'll have a really milky cup of tea. And then that sunlight. Nothing technical this weekend, just a nice 24 hours out while I could, out on the river and taking advantage of this brighter weather as the spring season kicks in and nature's coming back to life. Okay, so I've got the canoe packed up, ready to go. So I'm just going to take a nice leisurely paddle. The sun will be to my right, and then I'll probably go into it as the river meanders. So I've got a little bit of warmth, a bit of a freshness on the water, so it's quite nice. But it's coming up to about just gone 5 o'clock, so I've got about an hour's paddle back to put in. So yeah, just 24 hours out in the canoe, first time in 2017. So nothing over technical, just sharing the experience. And as always, hope you deemed some sort of interest from it. So always, as always, thanks for watching. Really appreciate your interest, and catch you in another video soon. Cheers. Take care.